Okay. It is a new thought. It's a new day, yes? Okay, good. Encore. Okay, so the title of my talk today is What's New? How many times has someone said to you, what's new? Like all week, right? What's new? So I called my aunt in Philadelphia last week, and she said, so what's new, Jimmy? Still calls me Jimmy. And I was like, and here's the thing. As I heard myself say nothing much, I knew I was lying. The thing is, when you say what's new to me, I may not have much to tell you in the way of anything's changed visually or, you know, out there, but I am so different. The way I look at this stuff is so different. So when you say what's new, you know, my immediate reaction is wanting to go, oh my God, everything's new. So what's everything new? And then it's like, well, actually nothing's changed, but everything's new. Anybody else feel that way? So that's where we're going to start today with what's new. So what does it mean to say what's new? Well, let's first of all look at the word new. The Webster Dictionary says recently born, built, or created. So the real question is it possible, is it even possible for anything to be old? Absolutely not. It can't be. Your life is new every single minute of every single day to the degree that you take your mind and you invest it with the newness that it has, the unlimited scope it has to see everything differently every time you look. Think about that. You get to really create anew every single moment. Karen could get up here right now and sing that song all over again with the four of them behind her all singing it over again. It would be brand new, even though you just heard the song. Because something new would be happening, because something's different in Karen. It has to be. We cannot walk this planet being somehow stuck in what was. Even if you do it mentally, then you just experience the stuckness of what was, which is new. Yes? Y'all following this? Okay, good. So Walt Disney said this, the king of new. I mean, think about what that man did. Think about, I mean, I don't like Disneyland, but it's an awesome place for many of you. And Connie's going to kill me because Disneyland is like her church. Yes. So Walt Disney said, we keep moving forward, opening new doors and doing new things because we're curious. And curiosity keeps leading us down new paths. Curiosity keeps leading us down new paths. So, how curious are you in this world you're living in? How curious are you? How much curiosity fills your day? And how much of the same old fills your day? It's an important question to ask ourselves. How much curiosity do I have? Am I curious about how this is going to turn out? Or do I set my mind up in a pattern that knows how it's going to turn out, and therefore it turns out based on what I'm knowing about it? What if I'm willing just to be curious about everything? What if I'm willing to wake up in the morning and just be curious? What's my day going to be like? Instead of, I got to do this and this and this, and I get to watch Scandal later on tonight. What if we could just wake up and just be so curious about everything that we met everything with a new consciousness? Because here's the deal. You are meeting everything with a new consciousness. You just don't know it all the time. I don't know it all the time. Sometimes I think it's just same old, same old. And it never is. It never is. And that is the very definition of unlimited. Not allowing anything to be the same over and over and over again. Really stepping into, and even when you have an experience that's not so good. How many of you have had experiences or business ventures or anything that just didn't go the way you wanted them to go? Or jobs that didn't go the way you wanted them to go, right? Okay, do you want to stay there and get stuck in that and just be thinking about that and then use that the next time you go to think something? No, you want to be curious and interesting. That just led me to this. And this led me to that. And this has nothing to do with that. It's all new. So I was on the plane traveling to Toronto. On the way home from Toronto. And I pick up the Delta SkyMiles magazine to look at it. And there's an article on Los Angeles. And I go, like, I need to read that. So I don't. And then I went, why do I should look at it and see if it says anything interesting about Los Angeles. So I go back and I start reading it. And I am reading things about Los Angeles that I never knew. Restaurants. It was a list of all these restaurants. I've not been to any of those restaurants. And they're all amazing restaurants. They're like, here you get Cajun food, you go downtown and try this. In West Hollywood, you go here. How did I miss the West Hollywood one? And all of these amazing restaurants, and I'm reading them. And so I take out my phone, and I start jotting them down. And I have them. I was going to read them to you today, but I don't want to lose my notes. I'll put them online somehow. I'll put them on my Facebook page, all the restaurants. The top 10 restaurants in Los Angeles that everyone should try. And so I have made it my goal to try every single one of them. I have not gone to one yet. But we almost did last night, right, Noor? I was like, let's look to see which restaurant we could go to until we realized that neither of us were particularly dressed for any restaurants. So the article really got me to think. And it started really making me realize that I have little bit been living in Los Angeles as though I know what Los Angeles is. Los Angeles is different every day you wake up. Every time I take a walk, I walk every day, I walk around my neighborhood, there's something different, something new. If you say to yourself, I insist on seeing something new, you could do it right now in this room. What haven't you seen before in this room? I own this room. So what haven't I seen before in this room? Martha. No, I've seen Martha before, but I haven't seen her sign before, right? We're all looking at you now, Martha. So I really want to see something. Back to me. So what haven't you seen in this room before? I mean, really look around. What haven't you seen before? I'm really looking for something. Those flowers are brand new. Oh my God, right in front of me. See, now I'm making my point. What I haven't seen before is right in front of me. And that's the way it works. So yesterday, how many of you have seen the movie Hello, My Name is Doris? It's really a beautiful movie. It's really a great movie. Well, Noor and I decided we wanted to see this movie like weeks ago. And every time we go to see it, somehow we don't get there. So yesterday we decided we're going to go see this movie. And so I decide, because I'm on this thing, let's not just go to ArcLight Sherman Oaks and get our normal chairs and then, you know, go eat in the same place at the ArcLight little restaurant there. I was like, nope, all new. We're going to go to a new place. So we go to Landmark, not the thing you guys are all doing, but to the Landmark movie theater, right? And so we go to Landmark. We get up to buy our tickets. We're in time. I even got home from the gym in time. We're in time. We're not dressed very well, but we're dressed. And we get there, and I go up and I say two for Hello, My Name is Doris. They look at Noor and they say, can I see her ID? And I was like, to see a movie? And I was like, well. I said, and she says, oh, I don't have my ID. And she goes, well, you have to be 21. I went, well, it wouldn't matter anyway, then would it? I said, we have to be 21 to see this movie? She says, no, but the Landmark is like a bar, so you have to be 21 to get in. And I'm like, we will never see this movie. So we look at it, and we find out where's the next movie, and the next movie was on Pico, and we couldn't get there in time, but we could get to the next movie after that. And I was like, great, I've never been to that movie theater on Pico. I don't think I ever go to Pico. I know where it is. I pass it on the way to Marcy and Al's house, but I don't know. I've never stopped there. So we decide to go to Pico. Then I say, no, let's go to West Hollywood for brunch. Looking the way we looked. And so we did. So we went to West Hollywood. Now, I've already been to Café de Troyes. Is that what it's called? Yes. Café de Troyes. Of course you know. Café de Troyes. But Noor hasn't. So I say, I'm going to give you a new experience. So we go to Café de Troyes. And she gets to look at the drag queens that are hanging out in bars, and which she points out to me, and all this stuff. And we're having, we had like the most amazing, amazing brunch, brand new. Then we go to Pico to see the movie, and brand new movie theater, and it was the movie theater with the big lush chairs where you just sit in these big couches and watch the movie. And then we watched the movie, and it was a beautiful movie. And then there was a Banana Republic right nearby. And I had this, I knew they were at 50% discount. So the whole day, lest you think I'm just here to tell you what I did yesterday, the whole day was about doing things that are new? How can we go to new places, step into new experiences, meet new people, and get out of the idea that I always have to do the same thing all the time? And so we did. And we had an amazing day. So here's the question. What stops us from wanting the new? What stops us? So there are three things that stop us, and I did my research on this to find out. This is kind of a conglomerate of what a lot of the psychologists and psychiatrists actually say about what keeps someone in their place of fear around the new things. So the first thing is fear of being wrong. That we don't want to do new things because we're afraid we'll do it wrong. That we'll look stupid doing it. That people will judge us because we're trying something new. Like, do you ever see something you want to wear and you're just like, I don't know. I have literally tried clothes on and thought it looked fabulous and had someone look at me and go, oh no. Anybody else? Right? Yeah. I mean, I've shopped with John Livesey and I will try clothes on and he'll go, darling, no. This is not you. And I won't buy it most of the time. Sometimes I will, or I'll stick it in the bag when he can't see. And I wear it when I'm not with him. But just think about it. We don't want to look silly. We don't want to look stupid. So we don't try that new thing. We don't try that new idea. And it really goes all the way up to our careers. We don't try that career because it's kind of silly. It would be silly to dedicate our entire life to baking cookies, Mrs. Fields. Be silly to spend our whole life just developing new kinds of ice creams, Amy. That's Texas. You don't know her. Great ice cream. Think about it. That's the primary way, fear of being wrong. And the next one, which I love, being stuck in a comfort zone. How many of you can really look at your life and say, you know what, I am a little stuck. I'm a little comfortable. Where I am, I'm a little stuck in my comfort zone. And the comfort zone is all about falling prey to race consciousness. You fall into this comfort zone because everyone else is comfortable there too. So we're all comfortable and bored together. So think about that. You are in your comfort zone and it feels comfortable. And I'm not saying comfort should feel bad. Comfort feels good. But you know what feels, I find, you know what feels even better than comfort? Passion, excitement, even fear, when it's the kind of fear, it's like the fear of the unknown, but I'm going to let that fear happen. I love John Livesey took my ministerial class when I was in Texas, and one of the things he taught the students was, what do you do with the fear? And he talks about the butterflies in your stomach, and what John says is, all you have to do is get those butterflies to fly in formation. It's not about the butterflies. Let them fly, but direct them. Put them in formation. So that's more exciting. So those of you that are sitting here with a comfort level of 100%, you should get a little uncomfortable. Allow yourselves to be uncomfortable. And that's the thing. Are we willing to be uncomfortable enough to step into something new? Because it can be uncomfortable. I did take my first piano lesson with Paul Horner. Talk about uncomfortable. I mean, the poor man, he's sitting right there, the poor man, he said, show me what you can do. I did it, and he was like, oh, dear. He was very supportive in his way. And he basically he was like, well, that's good. He goes, so clearly we're going to have to start from the beginning. And that was uncomfortable to me, because I know what I know. It's not going to be easy to forget what I know and let these fingers try it. And I've been here in the piano room all week trying to learn something new about something I know so much about, which is actually not much, apparently. So the second thing is getting out of your comfort zone. Are you willing? And here's the thing. If you're in your comfort zone, you're literally going against everything in you that naturally wants to break out. That's how we create diseases. That's how we get upset. That's how we have migraines. That's how relationships don't work out, because we're stuck in a pattern that doesn't serve us in the first place. And if we were just living our lives spontaneously, allowing the new, as Elizabeth Gilbert says, to live us from the creative side of the expressiveness of our lives, if we allow that to happen, then you know what? Everything that needs to come forward comes forward. That's what that's all about. So that's the second one. And the third one, and this is the real biggie. One of the reasons why we fear what's new is because we have a fear of the unknown. We are an extremely controlling culture. Does anybody find that in their lives? Anybody else here feel like they are a little controlling? How many of you would at least say you're a little controlling? How many of you think you're a control freak? Thank you, Jose. Yes. Okay, Bonnie, you're a control freak? Actually, I knew that. So somewhere between a little bit controlling and control freak, we all live. So it's a little scary for us to let go of that, to step into something brand new and not know what's going to happen. We all want to at least know a little bit of what's going to happen. When was the last time you literally dove into something and had no idea, bless you, how it was going to turn out? What if you set your goal this week to do one thing that you had no idea how it was going to turn out, but it was something that interested you and you just did it? What would that change? You know, something like that, one little thing like that could literally turn your life upside down, because you would literally start stepping into the new. So how do you conquer? How do you overcome this fear? So yesterday we were in the car driving back from the movie, and I was identifying just a little too much with Doris in the movie. You know, Doris is like 70 years old, and she falls in love with this 29-year-old guy from New Girl. And it's a beautiful movie, beautiful movie. And I was identifying, thinking, wow, okay, I'm 61. I can totally see how somebody who's single at my age, you know, who would you date, you know, all that. And I'm Nora, poor Nora, has to sit and talk to me about these things at the ripe old age of 16. And somehow I said, you know what? And we talked about me getting even older. I said, you know, I want to be able to talk to your grandchildren like I talk to you, which means I would have to be probably about 105 for you to have children at a certain age and for them to grow up to that, to 17 years old. And so we're talking. I said, and I don't mind being 105. I want to know what it's going to feel like to be, not soon. But I want to know, I want to be willing to go into that world unknowingly. What's it going to be like to be 105, 110? Because they're telling us now we could live to 130. And I want to be okay with that. And when I did speak to my aunt this week, I mentioned that to her. She said, oh, good God. I am, oh, no, 90. I don't want to hit 90. She's 86. And I was like, really? You want 4 years left? She goes, two, three, whatever. And I was like, well, and so it is. I'll get my plane ticket now. which will be very sad. But I'm good at 120. And I said to Nora, I said, so long as I know who I am, so long as I can look down at my feet and recognize them as feet, I said, I want to be here. I want to be mentally here for that. I said, you know, I want to be able to know what our vision statement is. And I said, love only, forget everything. And Nora went, oh my God, it's happening. You're already forgetting. And we just start laughing. And then I went, wait a minute. I think I've done it. I think I've set how we actually conquer fear. Love only, forget everything, but remember who you are. Right? Yes. So, but wait, here's the best part. So I'm this morning I'm going over my talk, and Nora's in the bathroom. I got him so high now. Nora's in the bathroom, and I'm working on my talk, and I'm going over the notes, and I'm like, what was it I wanted to say? What was it that covered? I run down the hall, and I'm like, Nora, what was that thing I said that conquered fear? What was that thing? And she went, I don't know. I don't remember. And so I go, wasn't important then. And then she goes, Dad, oh my God, it's love only, forget everything. And we just forgot it. So that's the answer. That is the answer. Forget everything you think you know. If you want the new, you gotta forget the old. Now, you will not forget all the greatness that you learned from it. That all is inherent. It's who you are anyway. So if you are willing to forget everything in order to step into something new. Don't be the person that knows how it's going to turn out. Be willing to know that no matter how it turns out, it's going to turn out well. And I don't mean some la-la land, it's all going to be good no matter what happens. No, because what you're really saying is, anything could happen, but I'm going to be okay with it. No. No, it's more about just saying, it will be good. Align yourself with the universal good of life and say, it will be good, because it already is good, because all there is good. And therefore, I can undertake anything that's new. You know, I'm going to be teaching the Elizabeth Gilbert book, Big Magic. So I'm reading it every single day. And I love, she has such a funny, quirky, bizarre way of looking at life. You know, Eat, Pray, Love was one of my favorite books, and I actually even liked the movie. Anybody? Yeah, I liked the movie. Kevin was like, torture, torture. I'm telling them what you said. He's in Texas watching this. So I'm reading this book, and it's just so exciting to hear somebody talk about, get out of your way. There is a creativity that is you, that is living you, and the only reason why it doesn't succeed is because you keep getting in its way with everything you think you know. So, love only, forgive everything, forget everything. Remember who you are. But that is the important part. Remember who you are. And that's really what I mean. I'm okay if I forget details and forget things or forget where my keys are every single day, you know. But if I remember that I am, as Terry said, you know, I am God, and that means I am greatness on demand. And one of the things about the I am God thing, and I will talk about for a moment here while I have you on that topic, a lot of people have a hard time with that concept, and I understand why people have a hard time with that concept, because our idea of God is so ingrained within us. But as Terry also said, I grew up Roman Catholic too. God is everywhere. I'm part of everywhere, so I must be God. And I don't have to say I'm just a little part of God, because I think that really undercuts God. That undermines the truth of who and what we all are. And because, you know, someday, soon this summer, Anita Marjani will be here to talk to you about her experience. When she explains you her experience of what it was like to be dead and then to really get it, how we are all one thing, and then all of a sudden come back in, and I don't want to give her talk or anything, but you really get it. You just audaciously walk around understanding who you are. So remembering who you are is the big part of it. So everything's new when you remember that you are looking from a new mind at every single moment. Your mind is never the same. You trying to hold on to it and keep it the way it was doesn't stop it from continuing to expand. It just builds up a lot of resistance in you. So I'm going to say and offer to you this week, our final week of Unlimited, to really dive in to this unlimited notion of the new. To allow the new to be your new way of thinking. New thought, new mind, new world, new peace, new joy, new life. Pick that one thing for you. Pick that one thing you can do this week that you haven't done yet. And where you actually jump into it without undermining yourself by saying, what's going to happen? If it's yours to do, do it. And what's going to happen comes through you. It's not out there. So you want to know the answer to what's new? And the answer that we could all start using when someone says, what's new? One word answer. Everything. So what's new?
Everything.
Namaste. All righty. Okay, everyone take a deep breath. Oh, you okay? Are you okay? Did you hurt yourself?
Yeah, of course.
Next
time I'll use the step.
Okay, good. Yeah, that's a good idea. Hey, that's new. You've never fallen on your face in front of people.
I've never fallen on my face before. That is new. I wasn't afraid either.
No. And look. And
now I want everyone to forget everything I just did.
Well, yeah, it's on film.
I know.
Okay, so everyone take a deep breath. Yes, that's perfect. Everyone take a deep breath. So, this is a great song for you. It's just going to give you an opportunity to forget everything. So here we're going to do. We're going to let go of everything that y'all got in your mind, what you want to let go of. Here we go. Let's do it. Yes, right? I don't know. They move on their own.
I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, I am healed, I am made whole.
No, just let it all go.
I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. It's a new thought, it's a new day, it's a new me, and I am letting go.
Yourselves up to the new.